And welcome back to PGL Tavern Tales. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Raven and Thijs joining me on the couch to bring you the next game, which is going to be G2 Life Coach versus Temple Storm Gaara. And those guys know exactly what's going to happen. We are calling this tournament Raven Tales sometimes.
And not sure how much the organizers would agree with this, but we're taking over, so it's fine.
All right, and the G2, another G2 player. RDU unfortunately eliminated from the tournament, but then Life Coach has a really good chance. And what do you think are his chances here?
Well, I saw the pick and bend phase while that was going on, and I think it it really is in the favor of Life Coach, but I also fought that with my own strategy often, and it didn't really pay off. So, yeah, it's... The hard thing in last year standing here with having three decks is if one matchup just doesn't go your way, you can be really in a disadvantage if you lose the first game or if you have a deck that you specifically needs to win that matchup badly. It can go rough, so I definitely give here the favor, but it's going to be a close one, I would say. We also don't know what Gaara is exactly playing. I know what Life Coach is playing, but...
Okay,
it's
exactly.
Yeah, we'll see.
Well, we know they are playing 9 classes for sure, but there are different options, right? Like we talked in the cap that you have a lot of different strategies. We've seen Temple Mage, we've seen Freeze Mage, and were there any specific changes? Well, you probably will not tell me right now because it's a secret.
Don't reveal the strategy.
Would you say that this tournament format really makes you make changes that are critical in the decks that would not work on ladder, but in the specific format they can actually work?
I would say yes in some way. I still think matchups are really close at the moment. I felt back in the day you really had like some matchups where you could get a big advantage. Now you can still do it, but it's still like some decks will never have a worse matchup than 40%. Druid is a great example. I don't think you can go with Shaman lower than that. So with having three or four decks being really strong at the moment, it's still hard to get your win in with one of the weaker classes against these
All right.
Classes.
And obviously, we have overall 16 players. We've just finished Group B. If we can actually look at the Group B and what happened there. So, Raven, take us through what happened in the Group B and why are those guys on top?
Yeah, so we saw Tessen go through Super JJ and RDU, so probably the underdog of the group overall, actually just having a really strong performance, and he made it through the winner's bracket of Group B, whereas we saw just recently JJ take down RDU in a very... crazy series with his Druid 3-0-ing overall, so pretty nuts group to start the day off with. And yeah, so it's going to be Tessa and Super JJ through from Group B that are going to be playing tomorrow.
And we actually had Group A and Group C being played at the same time. So Group A, 6-0, going through with Crane and Colento losing to Angelo Shaggy, then Angelo Shaggy losing to 6-0, Colento also losing to Crane. So a really tough group with 6-0 and Crane on top, 6-0, winning the Star Ladder tournament this year. Also one of the players supposedly to be on the roll, almost qualifying for LCT and having a really great performance. Crane finishing the top in the final. Second in the DreamHack. Group C, we see Thijs unfortunately eliminated.
Yeah.
Thijs, what happened there?
Yeah, against Orange, I get the first swept by the Shaman, something I thought my lineup was really good against, but still, couldn't really get it through. I thought my Priest went so well in practice, and now it felt so bad that it
I'm sure many
got so
people would
that
disagree that Priest went well in practice.
And then afterwards, 3-0 against Hybrid Hunter, something I was like a little bit weak to, but I would not expect. I lost with the Zoo against it, lost with... lost with the Warrior against it. I have some decks I thought would be good against Hybrid Hunter, but definitely not going out too great. So I really hope.
But you get to cast now, so it's
I got
fine.
To cast now, but I also really hope that because I think me and Adrian also RDU, we practice actually really hard, a week long. So I really hope now that we came with a little bit risky strategy for sure, but I really hope it will now pay off for him because otherwise it will be feeling even more painful.
Hopefully. I just want to ask you because you are the specialist in Conquest. Like whenever there's Conquest being played, you come on top. This is last year standing.
Yeah.
Is last year standing your like, you know, weak point?
Kryptonite.
Yeah. it might be. I feel what I just like so much in Conquest is you can like target things harder. Now you have to target the whole field. What is kind of cool. But if something just doesn't go your way, then you are already you are so behind. And I really like Last Hero Standing too. Maybe it's just a bigger challenge for me personally. But Conquest is definitely a thing I feel more comfortable with. Then the tech decisions really gonna pay off often. Where now, if people know what you're already like targeting, it gets already a little weaker.
Talking about targeting, Raven, what do we see here?
Yeah, so we can see the picks and bans on the screen now. We see Live Coach went for the first pick of Warrior because Gaara banned out Druid first. And this is something we saw, you know, we've seen a couple of players do so far, which is an interesting one. We genuinely thought it would be Warrior or Shaymin every single time as the first ban, but opened up Warrior for Live Coach and then followed up with the Rogue and Warlock after Shaymin and Hunter was banned out. So again, Hunter looking like a quite high priority ban.
Is that a high priority ban here?
Well, in Gaara's opinion, it is. I don't think it is overall. It's a bit of a surprise. But yeah, Gaara banning out Hunter's a bit interesting one there. But yeah, it's pretty cool overall. Gaara gets to play his Hunter.
Both banning Priest at the end, by the way. That's what I'm trying to say, right? Come on.
There's this really weird thing where people like banning Priest or playing it, and it's like, why is this deck being played? Or class being played, should I say.
What is going on in this format a lot is not people like are not that scared for Priest, but they target something so well with the rest that they kind of want to force your opponent into that specific class because your lineup is so good against it then. Yeah, then I guess you sometimes
it just looks
the
weird to be like, yeah, I'm banning, you know, this class everyone says is unplayable, I'm going to ban it out so he can't
Both players last picked Warlock. Last picked Warlock.
Yeah, Warlock is a great class, and also I have a couple of archetypes. Mm-hmm. Probably Zoo is the strongest one at the moment, but you've yourself tried Malygos Warlock at some point. Is it viable, or?
I would say it is, I think it's tier 2, tier 3, but if you can ban Shaman, the deck is definitely great. It is really good against Druid. I just had really consistent, they have problems with dragons in general, and you keep removing really efficiently. I was like trying it out, but it really reminds me a little bit on the Malygos Warlock that we had. Mm-hmm. A little bit less bird, a little bit more control.
Alright, so we will see. Life Coach is able to keep that Warrior, and he is opening with it. Gaara is starting with the Shaman. Guys, take it away.
Okay, thanks, Nimsh. And this looks like Life Coach is on this Dragon Warrior, with the Curator becoming a pretty common card in that deck now. As soon as it came out, I was like, yeah, we can just put monkeys back in the deck, and it starts to get some work done, especially just drawing Finley just in case as well for that third draw. So looking pretty okay. Not the best opening hand, has the Fire War Axe and double execute, but other than that, it doesn't look too great. Whereas Gaara's playing a mid-range Shaman or Totem Shaman as he's playing that Totemic Might.
Yeah, it looks like a really more in Totem Shaman. It has been getting way more popularity now on ladder, and one of the matchups that is weak for the deck is Shaman, I would say. So if you can bend it away, you actually have a pretty fine matchup now against the more a little bit more aggressive versions of Warrior. I don't think it's that great against Control Warrior.
Oh, that's interesting. I think the deck I've played a little bit of. I don't know if it's this version, of course, especially because we're casting Gaara. He likes to do some funky stuff in his deck sometimes. Mm-hmm. But like, I feel like a lot of the control matchups, the Shaman does really well because you can just hit and press Totem every turn almost, and then you always threaten something crazy. Like if there's potentially a Bloodlust in the list, or even just Thunderbluff getting that instant value of the hero power in the one turn. But see how it turns out in the end, and see if Gaara actually goes for the Culling Totem Golem. Doesn't really have a great follow-up. Normally you want to do that with a one drop, but also you kind of want to put the pressure on quickly versus Warrior.
I would really like it here because with the three drops you're kind of stuck. If you do it next turn, the Totem Golem, you can still not develop your either Tuska or Mana type. Maybe he's going for a strategy where he wants to coin one of them out. Into the two drop, it's also pretty solid to have the Totem Golem, what is like the Guardian or the Fairy Dragon normally.
Yeah, you almost guarantee any minion that's played is gonna get killed or cleaned up by the Totem Golem at least. And Life Coach has a choice between the Zoth First Mate off curve, or just equip the Fire War Axe and have it ready. But
it's a little bit awkward here. You are not really sure what you're gonna face. You can already consider that there might be, or that there might not be in Totem Golem. Normally, it's a pretty common play. People coining it out. Like
it feels weird not to, right? Like
it's. The reason behind it is the turn you want to overload yourself. It's fine to do it on turn two. You can still play your one mana spell, maybe play in one mana minion. When it goes to turn three or four, you really want to play the power play. So that's the reason behind it. I guess you can consider attacking now because it's going to be.
Especially because War Axe is in hand as well. I guess the idea is, like, as far as I'm aware, Life Coach doesn't know what type of Shaman this is. So, you know, if there's a more slower shaman, then he won't want to just equip War Axe and be like, yeah, okay, you know, it's there because maybe there's some weapon removal, for example, or it just skips a turn in which he doesn't need the War Axe for so long anyway.
This weapon actually is a pretty, the From the Nasad is pretty solid against shaman. It just, here on board, you can kill the hero power, but it's always. You don't want to spend like resources killing a hero power from the shaman, but leaving it up can get really painful.
Yeah.
And here we already see the toting white. That's an,
yeah, I really like the play actually. I think a lot of players I've played against at least have always try and wait for like a full board to play Totemic Might, whereas it's actually you can get more impact from it if you just, you know, play on one or two minions and make them stick to the board and then build off that. But we can see Life Coach having double execute available gonna clear this up pretty easily, but Totem Golem's just pulled out an execute, which is gonna feel pretty good.
I mean, Volant, but Volt, so you could have had a little bit extra HP on it. But is it burr? Like, what does it? Do you play around something by leaving it to 6 or 4? I don't see a reason why it will matter here. Sometimes I agree, I will do it, but you are not playing around a single card. Maybe Varex, but yeah, then he loses a 1/3 weapon and he plays Varex on turn 3. So
yeah, you kind of take that as a victory in itself to a certain extent. So Tuskar actually got out the Flame Tongue Totem, so got a pretty decent result there, but nothing that Life Coach can't really handle if he wants to. He can leave the Flame Tongue Totem this turn, but having no 3 or 4 drops in this deck is kind of crazy. You run so many, like a lot of the time you can even mulligan them away because there's still like Alexstrasza's champions more than likely, you know, Frothing Berserkers, Monkeys, like you've got so many options and Life Coach shouldn't have any of them available. The only redeeming factor is he has 2 Corruptors that he does at least have a Dragon for, so he can get value from the Corruptors, but this turn feels horrible already.
Yeah, and this is what kind of hurts you a lot against the mid-range shaman, that you have this kind of turn because now you have to react a little. And normally if that is your spot as a Dragon Warrior against the shaman, you want to be a little ahead now he's just missing that one drop that will be on the board, and then he had the perfect ways to react.
Yeah, and there's always the frustration as well that if a reasonably sized minion comes out this turn, then the Corruptor, you kind of want to just Corruptor the Flame Tongue Totem because it's a very clean kill. But then, you know, say the thing from below comes out, then does he have to Corruptor and weapon into that, which is going to take more damage? And then the Flame Tongue Totem's still alive. So then it just causes more and more problems when Tuskar Totemic kind of gets like Flame Tongue Manitide, for example. You know, ones that you don't really want to deal with, but kind of have to.
So yeah, well, the thing from below is okay here. You would like to combine it a little bit better with more another totem or with the mana tide, but not really the option here to go for other plays. You can drop the mana tide that directly dies to the Warrex. Turn 5 is the Black Wing Corrupted turn normally, so you wanna like at least accept it a little bit. And if you go up with 2 minions of 3 HP, I will feel a little bit playing too much.
Do you ever consider like mana tide and primal fusion? At all, just to put it out of the range of one of the weapons. I don't mind this.
Yeah, I think if you want to go for the mana tide, you definitely have to primal fusion now.
Because it never feels great when you can just thing from below in a turn. Normally, the power of thing from below is that you can almost always play a full turn and then drop it as 0 mana to just really create a huge board presence.
It also is a turn where I feel that with the Hand of Gara, you really want to get that draw in, like Lightning Storm being reactive, Bloodlust just being dead for the whole game until the end. Definitely want to get something in here. And yeah, you are just still making your thing from below pretty cheaper. Oh, the dragon coming just one turn a little bit too late here.
Yeah, if that was the other way around the draw, it would have been insane.
Also gets a little annoying here for a Life Coach because you want to kill this Mana Tide. I think you have to. I think the Mana Tide is way more priority than this Flame Tongue Totem at the moment.
Still frustrating though.
Yeah, well, you take some little bit extra damage. Life is still fine. You're playing against a mid-range shaman, so I guess you're fine with taking the face hit here. Definitely have to respect the mana tide.
Yeah, can't really leave that up to just keep cycling because it's going to do is just empower Gaara to be able to really put even more pressure on, especially when he has the reactive cards like Lightning Storm. And there's a second one though.
Both players
it's definitely
are
not what he was after.
Both players are having a little bit of reactive hands here going on.
Yeah, it was kind of rough. You play Thing from below and you just know it's already going to be traded into very cleanly by the Corruptor that's on the board.
Would like to execute this thing from below, but the problem is you have to deal at least already 3 damage into it, a thing from below. There is no way of dealing less damage. So execute gets a little weak here.
Yeah, there's not much else for it, is there?
I mean, we definitely the Flame Totem has to die here. You can do it in 2 different ways.
I wield the power.
Okay, so it looks like he's going with the execute, yeah. So like you said, a little bit weak, but it still gets the job done, and that's both executes gone now for life coach.
Yeah, but now you're on the board.
Yeah,
now
I was going to say, like, so now if anything huge comes out or a major problem, then, you know, you're not going to have a very easy answer to deal with it, but you have 2 Blightwing Corruptors so, and a War Axe still equipped for 1 charge, so looking pretty good overall. Okay, so life coach, no surprise, taking his time. Over how he wants to do this. Looks like he might actually. Okay. Thought that looked like he was going to swing the axe into it then and just trade into the 1-1, which would have been a little bit strange. But he doesn't. He just clears up the Flame Tongue Totem and leaves 2 5/4s on the board and the War Axe. So looking pretty good so far. And Arrow will want spell power and he didn't get it.
Actually, a really big one here because it one already buffed the Spirit Claws and the Lightning Storm can even get the high roll going on here.
So once to see a double 3 roll, didn't quite get it. But you can clear up both now with the Totem and the Rockbiter anyway. So not too terrible. Can clear up the board, but again, you're clearing the board just to give the Dragon Warrior, you know, like the initiative to just start playing more minions.
Okay, wants to start developing the weapon here, keeping on with the Rockbiter. Kind of think it's fine here.
He has the second Lightning Storm, right? So, you know, if another minion comes down or two, he can actually Lightning Storm, guarantee the kill on the Corruptor, and then hopefully try and polish off anything else that survives there. Okay, so there's a few options for Life Coach here. Corcoran Elite normally feels okay. To like just get on the board, start trading away the even just the totems, because versus mid range, just the totems themselves are threats a lot of the time. But and you have just seen a lightning storm as well, so you could feel pretty safe about that.
This is just something I expected from Life Coach. He's like, oh, I can now get the value off the Acid Ray, can do it safely. So I really want to like put it on here now. You lose the dragon for the guardian though, but I mean you already played double corruptor, so your two important cards that need the dragon are gone.
And also, you're not really under any amazing threat to acquire the taunt yet, anyway. So you may as well go with a slightly bigger minion. And he's got to decide what he wants to do with the rest of his turn. Whether he uses Blood Twicker to clear up, or just puts the War Axe into the 1-1.
Yeah, I don't think that. I mean, the Iker is not really used to. You don't really want to go 1-for-1 against totems here. I think with the Iker Ghoul, what just works pretty well together, kind of want to stick on that. Ooh, that's a pretty solid draw because Gar is running a little out of cards, and I was even considering Bloodlust here fast. Because of it will kill 2 minions on board, where I feel it's a little bit of a dead card, but it might also be your win condition.
Yeah, and you have a 50-50 chance to actually just get the Spell Power Totem in this position, which, like we said earlier, buffs the weapon and the Lightning Storm, so this looked pretty good. Overall, he had a decent chance of getting it. Did get it as well, so he can start to pile more pressure on with the weapon, or he can just hold off for now. And you know, 3 damage at this point doesn't really change anything to face. He really needs to use the weapon to build up his own board to really put the pressure on.
So the spell power totem we definitely have to respect in this deck. There is a lot of spell damage going on. The weapon just getting 2 extra damage makes a lot of trades possible. So. I think that is one you really want to expect. We see here now the second Lightning Storm being played, so it might give you a little bit of knowledge that we can now play 3 minions on board, and that's actually what Life Coach is going to do here now, just continue with 3 minions.
Yeah, I mean, even if the deck's running a Maelstrom Portal as well, you're suddenly not too afraid of that. There needs to be spell power, and even then there needs to be some extra damage to clear up the board, so I agree, I like this, especially after the 2 Lightning Storms, you're feeling pretty free. Uses the War Axe to face. He's actually pressuring Gaara's health total quite a lot now, and he has the second War Axe to continue on with the damage or trade as he sees fit. So Life Coach looking like he's in a pretty good position, although Gaara's going to be able to clear up some of this himself anyway.
It's getting a little bit close now, where the Warrior's kind of running a little out of cards, but same issue is going on for Gaara. little bit annoying that this Twilight Guardian doesn't have the Dragon synergy. The new Dragon Warrior kind of relates a little bit on the creator now, with no slams being in the deck, and it's one of your biggest card or cards. Well, here, Life Coach actually the option to pick the aggressive hero power. And I think that's the play, because you already can, with the weapon, can just put him at 2. So
yeah,
I was going to say, at
this point, you're feeling pretty good with the weapon as well. You can even just drop the Guardian at this point. Who cares? You know, you literally, unless something crazy happens next turn, you pretty much guarantee the win, as the Shaman doesn't normally run any healing. That's, you know, not out of anything wacky, like a Scarab or something, well, you know, which Gaara could run, though, in him.
Gaara is not even looking at the card he's going to draw, so I guess there is no way of healing. And that is a little bit the weakness of, like, Shaman, super strong deck, super top tier for sure. If there is a weakness, well, there is no heal in the deck. So, yeah, once they take a lot of damage, and Gaara actually took quite some damage with the Spirit Claws, playing a little bit, passively with waiting with the Lightning Storms, taking damage in the game, and at the end, the Dragon Warrior with the aggressive weapons and charges called deal the damage that was needed.
Yeah, and Life Coach is now 1-0 up, and you know, in Last Hero Standing format, I feel like when you've already got a win with Dragon Warrior, you're only feeling better, because the deck itself is very powerful and a good all-rounder, I would say. There's not many decks that really just crush Dragon Warrior, knocking around at the moment at least. So
yeah, let's say the Control Warrior might be one of the decks, but if that's...
Yeah. When you know it's banned out, yeah, then you're feeling pretty good.
Ooh. Solid starting hand here for Life Coach. You have the Warks, you have the Nuzlocke Mate, and you have the aggressive Alexstrasza champion with the Dragon. I will just keep the whole hand here. you can mulligan away the Azure Drake, but I think guaranteeing yourself this Alexstrasza champion, where you already have the other options.
Yeah, and I think by the time you've used your other cards, you get to Drake anyway, so why not, you know?
Guardian probably still better, but I think this is like hand you say to.
It's risky. I'll throw away Azure Drake because I'll get Guardian.
I don't know what can go wrong. There comes a Squire or Villager, you go with the Mate. There comes an Flame Imp, you have the Warks. There comes a Voidwalker or an Malkrasar's Imp, and you coin out the Alexstrasza champion. So the flexibility of this hand is insanely great. Yeah.
And what do you think about the sort of, I'm just going to call it Zoo, but like new Zoo, where it's more discard-based with the Librarians, etc. And do you think the deck's like more powerful than the old one, or do you think it's still in like the experimental phase and not quite decided yet?
I think it has an higher power level. might hurt a little bit of consistency from the deck, I feel, because there can so much go on with the deck.
I mean, we saw it earlier from RDU.
The swings are insane. Like, sometimes you have these... like these busted early golems, or the silver golems. But sometimes you also have these games where you just don't get them on and you discard all your good cards.
Yeah, so definitely it's sort of high risk, high reward. Yeah.
One of the cards that might just not be worth it then is the Librarian. Like, that is the unquestionable card. That's the one I'm like figuring out how good is it, because sometimes it makes the deck sometimes insanely busted, but sometimes it makes it insanely weak.
Yeah. Definitely, I feel like more risky than the sort of original Zoo, or older Zoo, should I say. But this is going pretty okay for him so far. It doesn't look like he's under too much threat, although we can obviously see Fiery War Axes and the Alexstrasza champion in hand. But looks like it's going to have to be a War Axe turn to kill the Imp, right?
I still find it interesting that Gaara picked here the Warlock over the Hunter. I would say Hunter just has an okay shot against Dragon Warrior, but I feel, well, Zoo, is that what you... It's a close one, right?
Yeah, and it depends what kind of Hunter Gaara's playing as well, because there's secret variants, there's like trapless variants.
Yeah, that's true.
And then there's even Yashiraj Hunter, which is definitely a thing. I don't know how much of that deck you've played with just Barnes and Yashiraj in it, but there's definitely something to think about, at least, and something to consider. Just going to get the nice trades there with the Alexstrasza champion.
Get a minion on board, it will most likely even trade really well with the Flame Imp here. Ooh. So this is an interesting turn. You can here go with the Melksurge Imp Librarian, draw a card. You have also the Librarian on the board, but will draw you after. Do you take that value, or would you consider playing it a little... slower defensive,
yeah,
with the Peddler here.
It's a tough one, isn't it?
Peddler is not the best discard.
Yeah, because a lot of the time, Librarian's good like later on when you just want to cycle out the bad cards that you don't need at the moment. Mm-hmm. But Peddler's actually pretty decent, especially because you can either follow up with the Imp or the one mana spell you get. So you kind of want the one mana card you get.
You still kind of want to discard, right? I mean, this is why the Mogthor's Imp. You want to have a card to discard, otherwise you don't draw the card.
Yeah, it's definitely a tough
one. So I feel if you don't draw a good one drop here, what kind of happens here? You will you might regret to not go for the play now. I think Peddler. Yeah.
I thought Peddler was okay there.
Mm-hmm.
The Hungry Crab, just we can play something this turn over the Imp, because you also don't just want to throw an Imp on the board like past turn one when you know it might just die and not get any value, because now it's almost guaranteed that you'll try and go for Imp and Librarian next turn to just cycle and just put some more power on the board.
Yeah, it's kind of true. It was important to get the one drop here. So we can go for Finley, look for a 1 damage hero power, like the Druid. Oh wow, the Hungry Crab getting played before the Murloc.
I didn't even notice that.
Yeah, well, you can't keep the Hungry Crab then.
Just in case of Finley.
I was actually, when the creator came out, people were trying like Murlocs all over the place. And I just had that Hungry Crab there in my Paladin and in my Druid that I kept like in my starting guide. When it works, you just remember the times it worked, you know?
Yeah, it's
that's
fantastic.
That's important about that card.
It's actually so good when it does as well. Even if it is just on a Finley that's kind of already done its job.
So I think for Life Coach, it should be the Mage or the Druid against Suiya. I don't think you want to like have the time to life tap. Normally the Mage is just a better Druid hero power against Sue because you want to use it on board. But here the Druid hero power for this turn will be a little bit better to get that one armor. But over time, the Mage one should always outscale.
It's just like more flexible as well, isn't it?
You can just use it all the time without taking damage. Yep.
Ooh. So... This is one of those strange turns.
Yeah, now I'm like...
This is one of those awkward turns that this deck gives you now and again. So I think Imp gets played, right? Because you need to do something here. So Imp into... Would you even consider Soulfind Finley here? And just cycle?
I will play the Librarian. Because I feel Soulfinding and Finley is just...
True. You have that's true. You have nothing to like
you don't
deal
have
with
one
Finley
HP
though.
It's
with the ping, Finley's very annoying, that's all.
True.
Because Finley's gonna kill the Librarian probably anyway.
Yeah, but then the Finley also dies. So I won't be too
sad
about it. I don't know, if you don't get on board here, then where do you get?
You just rely on that Doomguard into double Silverware Golem later on.
I think I would always play the double minion here. I think you should never soul fire this.
Okay, going for the Librarian. Let's see what he cycles into. How overwhelming.
I'll consider using it here, but... Really, especially this version, what Gara's playing that plays the double soul fire, double PO, it's so snowbally. It's like it either rolls or it just doesn't. It goes really well or goes really bad, I feel.
Yeah, you kind of just sort of at the mercy of your draws to a certain extent to be able to use this deck optimally. And even though, like, I know a lot of players have talked about Soulfire in this list, and whether it's not Soulfire, sorry, Power Overwhelming, and whether it's actually good enough to run, or whether just Soulfire plus, you know, like swap out the Power Overwhelmings for something else is good enough. So, have you you guys decide that Power Overwhelming was good enough?
I to be honest, I haven't played Zoo enough to really justify it. I think it's really inconsistent in the deck. I feel you have so many ways to deal with it. Also, it's a card that will often be the discard because, or you wanna get rid of all your cards to get the good discards. But when you have PO in your hand, sometimes you just don't want to play it.
Yeah.
And then you.
And then it may as well be something else, something else to a certain extent.
That you can play.
You don't even run like tons of tokens in this list normally. Yeah. You know, there's no Forbidden Ritual, for example, to get even more value from. So.
This is also a little bit the annoying part of the Librarian. It draws indeed the card, but sometimes people just kill everything else besides the Librarian.
Yeah, just leave it alive. I'll take 3 damage a turn. Yeah. It's fine. I'll deal with everything else and just deal with 3.
So yeah, Life Coach getting better in a better and better spot, I feel now, with all the weapons and traits that go on. Has the option to go for the full trait here with the ghoul. But I kind of think you can now also, I mean, you...
I don't mind the ghoul ping here. You just empty the board, you let him have the card draw, because if you leave anything else on the board and say go for Azure Drake, then you run the risk of it getting traded into. And you could coin out Crusher, which is, you know, more resistant, but still, there are cards that can actually just kill it anyway, and then you sort of lose the board for not a lot, and allowed your opponent to trade well. I think the Ghoul's just nice and clean, and it saves your weapon as well.
With Ghoul, Ping, you can still, it saves your weapon, so you can even not consider. With, if you all know, there is like not a, there are not many boards you want to like Ghoul anymore from the Zooli.
Yeah, exactly. There's no like Forbidden Ritual you need to think about. Yeah. We've not seen him gang boss yet. So, you know, you're looking pretty okay for the Ghoul. I think you just take the value of it right there and then, but it's like Life Coach disagrees and going for the Azure Drake.
I'll consider playing the ultimate here, but yeah, it's just a 1-1.
Oof. This is not the best hand I've ever seen, Tyz.
Yeah, that's why I just don't like Fio sometimes. I feel you have so many ways of like trading all the time. With the Soul Fires. Probably have to draw, you know.
Yeah, he gets a clean kill on the Drake, so tidies that up pretty nicely. At least gets something he can also play this turn.
Do you play it? I would also tap you, maybe. I was like thinking, yeah, this can be good next turn with the Argus. So
yeah, that's true.
It's
actually
so weak for two mana to play 1-1 when you can draw a card. But Gaara doesn't get much going here. Like being on this board against a Dragon Warrior now that give you a turn 6, and they don't even are forced to react here. This is a target you can leave up. Life Coach can even consider here to go for more value and just get two draws in with the creator. The Finley already being drawn gives you the monkey and a Drake.
Yeah, and also what this does as well is if there's any way to trade up into a minion with this Defender of Argus, then it's probably going to be used on the Curator, which means his crushes are much more open and free to just end the game later. So I quite like the Curator myself. Just fill up his hand, why not?
We kind of have a good spot here for the Power of Roaming. I think this is one of the spots you really would like to play it. You can already go for the Darkshire Liberian this turn. By going PO Scry into Liberian, you give yourself the option to have a 50-50 discard of the Golem or Argus. Have the risk of discarding your Argus, so it's probably one of your better targets.
Yeah.
Your better cards for now. The game goes slow, you need it. Tapping here is really slow approach. Because you might still... I still felt you are in a spot to play the Liberian. And now you increase the chances of a bad discard. Or is he thinking of playing the Golem itself?
The light protects me.
I feel like if there's a chance you can get the Golem for free, you should just take it. Because it just makes the board so much bigger. And like as you said, the deck kind of revolves around these big swing turns, right?
Oh.
And sometimes you have to take the risk.
Just going for a 1-1 on turn 7.
Can you explain this to us, Tyz? Why would you not play any of the minions? Is it because he's setting up to guarantee a Silverware Golem next
He's
turn?
Playing the value game, but I think that is something you just can't do anymore.
Well, you've just seen Curator as well against the Warrior. The Warrior's got full hand.
That's why I just say I don't think you can do that ever anymore. You can sometimes the Zoo can do it against the Dragon Warrior, but Life Coach going for the a little bit greedy plays with Azure Drake and Curator, I would just now say, I'm in a bad spot. I will take my odds here and I go for the aggressive Liberian play. I just hope this is the game where I get the Golem on the board and I save the Argus to set even up a good turn.
Yeah, it'll be actually, if like one minion, like Argus plus another minion that you're going to draw next turn, more than likely, it's going to be a pretty reasonable outcome.
Because even if this might just survive because it's not worth dealing with, you got to face often two minions here. And how are you going to react into that?
Yeah, I mean, Life Coach has the option of going monkey into just Corcoran. Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, I've
just put as much power on the board as possible, split it across two minions and get aggressive.
I also thought about like Ghoul with the Nazod and then go with the monkey to like react already directly into the Squire. I'm not sure if Squire is like worth doing it. So now Gaara can actually play his Will hand by still guaranteeing the free silverware. You can just play the PO. And that's what kind of why I don't like the PO. Now I play it because I guarantee
you feel
the
you
discard.
Have to, yeah.
Yeah, why I already have to clear. It could also be a one drop, kind of. But
yeah,
it's of course, it can also get great value sometimes.
Yeah, and I think it just carries on with the overall theme of the deck to a certain extent. Sometimes it's fantastic, sometimes it's horrendous.
That can also be a good finish, you know.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Sometimes you get insane value from it because, you know, in itself it's a powerful card, but sometimes it's just awkward when you really need to aim discards.
I think what Garry's doing here had to happen last turn. Just go for it. And hope that...
he could have almost done this last turn,
yeah,
right?
Without the Argus.
Yeah.
And it had to go his way, where he discards the golem.
But sometimes that's what you have to do to win games, mm-hmm. right? What you have to make the slightly riskier choices just to have the bigger outcome potential.
Slivecoat's just going to the face. He's smoke. Not respecting it. He says...
I don't blame him, though. He's on 20.
Yeah.
He's on 20. His opponent's only got one tap, so he'll have a total of two cards to play with this turn. Oh, three with the Librarian kill, of course. But if the Librarian trades, then it's even less damage coming out anyway. So it's very unlikely that Garry could even get close to ending the game this turn. So yeah, why not go face and put a 9-9 on the board? I like it.
Yeah, and now you are also... Yeah, this is the thing with the Librarian. You're just kind of forced to trade here. Ooh, that's not a bad draw. The thing is, there is an Vortex here. And there is a 9-9. If he's not going to deal with that, this one, the Void Walker will not do the job. It will take the Varix and the ping to the face. It's just a straight lethal. So there has to. The trade into the 9-9 has to happen here. What is a really bad one.
Yeah, it doesn't even line up well, does it? The Doomguard has to go in. Unless
3-4-1. You can start with the Librarian, and there is the option to. Draw extra damage.
Yeah.
This one, now you're forced to trade everything here.
Yeah, and it feels bad when you have to trade everything, and you know your Voidwalker's dead next turn, 100%.
Really aggressive trade there from Lifeguard, but you see how good it actually was. It looked strange to sometimes attack phase, but yeah, well, if there is a time that you put the Zoo taps too much,
yeah, and a lot of the time, Zoo is not good at being the defender, right? Normally, Zoo always wants to be the aggressor and work that way. But when you put it under that much pressure and just Life Coach having mm-hmm. that much card draw, like I really like the coin into Curator turn because mm-hmm. it just made his hand so full, gave him so many options, and allowed him to just mm-hmm. pull ahead in that match.
Also, the Ezra Drake there, like being a little bit like taking it slow. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Zoo just wanting to trade anyway.
That's that's a luck and load, Thijs.
So, yeah, we are playing, I think we are having here an Yashar Hunter.
You think?
That is my guess now.
Yes.
Dodging the war, knowing with dodging the warrior matchup, but it's definitely with the execute a painful one.
Yeah. There he is. Okay. So for anyone who doesn't know about, do you want to explain what Yashar Hunter does and why it is even a deck?
I played it myself a little. I faced it already a little. Yashar Hunter is a deck. Well, we all know what Barnes can do. And it's probably one of the really snowball cards. But this Hunter that can do, the Hunter plays 26 spells. Two weapons, two minions. The two minions are Barnes and Yashar. And what you do with this Barnes is you get the Yashar. You gain the 1-1. You gain the Yashar as a 1-1 on board, and then you just get from the Yashar directly afterwards a 10-10 Yashar on the board. And yeah, it's insanely. If you want to like have a deck that is inconsistent, but winning almost guaranteed when you have like Barnes in your starting end. Definitely this Hunter.
Yeah, I think to be fair to the list as well, like the only reason it works more than just a complete gimmick deck is that Hunter has the power to actually, you know, the sort of bones of this deck is like Jorgenload, right?
It can play 26
where all
spells.
The spells are actually really good because a lot of them generate minions, and they can pile on a lot of pressure with the traps as well. Yeah. So and you have Double Call the Wild, which is enough to end a lot of games anyway. So the deck does have the potential to win without the exact Barnes into Yashiraj combo, but we can see already that Garry does have it available to him on turn 3 if he really wants. But as you said, the reason he didn't pick this against the Warrior is you pull out the 10-10 Yashiraj, there's no minions left in the deck, you're reliant on this 10-10 to win, execute, and it's just gone. So we'll have to see how it turns out.
Ooh, Garry actually going for the weapon here.
Okay.
I was considering the trap.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, is he trying to set up a situation where there's not a minion on board to potentially trade into Yashiraj, you know, to proc the execute, and then if a weapon attack happens, and you're like, okay, you took 10 to face. But then Nuzzoth's first mate is going to cause a problem with that, though. mean, you can trade in Freezing Trap, I guess. Next turn, you know, to try and just set up as awkward a turn for the Warrior to deal with Yashiraj as possible.
I think you called never go Freezing Trap here because of this 1-1. Like, it's it's, if that eats the secret, you're going to be a little bit sad.
Yeah, it's just one of the options you can give, so the 1-1 doesn't just go into Yashiraj, and then you can just execute it from there.
Oh, Life Coach really wanting like a 4-drop here, even a 3-drop next turn would really make this curve perfect. It's going to be an important draw for him. Gaara on the other side. Yeah, well, taking the Barnes a little slowly. I just like the Beard Trap felt really good for me at turn two.
Yeah, and I think
it
you
won't block the Fairy Dragon.
And I think if you have Barnes and the coin, you always want to try and coin into Barnes on turn three, because that one turn is, you know, one less turn your opponent can draw an additional card.
I guess Animal Companion is pretty okay next turn. I don't like the I don't like tracking anymore. Tracking one of your tools to that actually gets good. The risky thing with tracking is here, if he tracks his Yashiraj, it's not gonna proc any Mia from Barnes, so you just don't wanna touch that card anymore.
Yeah, the tracking is almost, until Barnes gets played, the tracking is a bit of a dead card.
Yeah, I kind of like the Explosive here. I think it's really nice. Oh, wow, that is a pretty important pickup here.
Yeah, look at his turn. If that was, you know, if that was a 5-mana plus card, or it'd be such a horrible
Everything
turn.
Below was okay.
Yeah,
though.
yeah, true. He did have a. It's not like this was like the one out. He had to make a play this turn, but still, like the uncurved Twilight Guardian off the top's looking pretty good for him so far. He's gonna think about secrets, you know, Snipe, for example. If that's gonna make the dragon a lot worse, but I think at this point, because it's so on curve, you don't really play around Snipe.
Reach you can make here, there will never be a Freezing Trap. It makes no sense into this 1-1, I would say. Maybe you don't even wanna proc the secret.
Yeah, well, I imagine he's not going to. If you played the Twilight Guardian, there's no reason to sequence it. That way you'd at least attack with the 1-1 first, right?
I would have loved if this Barnes one turn earlier, man. It's such a snowball card. It makes also the turn 4 so weak then, where...
Yeah. It's kind of rough now, because although he's gonna do it, because it's just the powerful play, but it just feels like it doesn't do anywhere near as much as it would the previous turn.
And
so there we go.
Life Coach for sure knows what he's facing here. Oh, and there's actually an Hymen, and this is an tech that... has been really popular now. It makes the deck a little bit more consistent. It's you play it with Yashiraj and Hymen.
Because you only play one, right?
Because you're like, if you draw your Yashiraj, you can play it. If you're tracking your Yashiraj, you are like the Barnes has no target anymore. And now with two minions, you add a little value, and this is also great. Like, do you want a 10-10 or a 6-5? Like, it's really important to get first the Yashiraj, because otherwise it you have a 1-1 Hymen.
Yeah, and it's like.
But
now
you just summon also and 3-4 with an Hymen at turn 4. But this is
Yeah, and Life Coach, what's good for Life Coach is he has a very easy way to deal with the 1-1 Yashiraj, because you don't want to leave it up for an additional turn, right?
Yeah, but this makes everything weaker, because the Hymen directly counters the Twilight Guardian. So you really look for a value trade now with the Guardian, I would say, into the Barnes, for example. Yeah, I like this. Just because of... you kind of lose the bow can also take this hit.
Yeah, with the frothing though, it presents like another threat that needs to be dealt with, as it's stacking up a lot of damage now. So it would trade with the Hymen to a certain extent, but yeah, just getting this Hymen out this early is kind of nuts. But again, I just think, what if this was turn three?
Yeah.
Turn three pawns, like, it would be insane. Even more difficult to deal with.
Yeah, what this deck can also do is, it's for Gaara, it's not bad at all to just trade the Hymen into the Berserker, I would say. We have 5 mana here, excess. You can consider keeping the bow for the reason of the charge. I think it's an... if you want to keep on with the bow, you have to play Freezing Trap here. And the Bear Trap most likely won't proc next turn again. And you have 5 mana, so that is a good way of going for something with the Freezing Trap. Maybe quick shot tracking.
Yeah,
maybe.
I was thinking just your Animal Companion first. Because if it's Huffer... Your game plan becomes very straightforward, right? You can just hover into the frothing and then just get aggressive with the Hymen, or trade into the Fairy Dragon. But I would personally look at Companion first, then sort of deal with what trap I wanted after that.
Okay.
See the tracking.
I see an 8 mana card, what I consider being
I don't
really
see
good.
I don't see the other two cards. I don't even know what they were. I'm not even Couldn't even tell you.
Also, this matchup, if it goes to the long game, Call of the Wild just strictly wins the game. Often, if it gets, if the Dragon Warrior can do it before turn 8, it's definitely gonna win the game.
Oh.
Yeah, this is also a risky play from Gaara. Like, just not respecting this flooding. And you know there are charges in the deck.
Well, there were four, right? There's not been any played yet.
It's now really obvious what the secret is. I will just, I think he is just, the control games is just him. With this Call of the Wild now in the hand, I would say it should always be his game.
Yeah.
Also explosive track popping here, so it just adds additional damage. Yeah.
And doesn't even kill the Corcoran either, so, you know, like, the Corcoran just does his job, goes back in hand, can come back again later.
It will be the same.
Yeah.
I really find it's...
It's the casual 12?
Yeah, I will.
You always put your face, right?
I think with the Call of the Wild in hands, you should just trade it. You add the freezing trap fell, you even get the bow charge.
Mm-hmm.
Now you risk potential a lot of damage.
The thing as well is, like, if Hyman traded in, mm-hmm. you'd still have hyenas, so it's not like you know you're losing the board. It's like, no, you have two hyenas, you've still got stuff you can do work with. You fought with Animal Companion next turn and a quick shot to keep the board low. And it's kind of crazy. Life Coach, why not do the extra damage at this point?
Yeah.
Like, why not? You're on 29, like, feeling pretty good as he just hits him for 12, and you know the Frothing Berserker has to be dealt with in one way or another the following turn, or it's just going to be game.
Well, we cannot take the attack now anymore in the Berserker, so we have to quick shot that. Yeah, Double Secret seems pretty solid here.
Mm-hmm.
Guess you trade off the 1-1. I like to play it clean here.
Yeah, and also there's always the question of what are the secrets, because you've traded the 1-1 makes it much more difficult to
prime. Oh no, he attacked with the high man. We just didn't saw the animation, I think.
that was weird.
Yeah. Okay, so execute draw here. It's okay. It's definitely not going to do the job, but it kind of makes with this 6 mana play.
Yeah, this is good. Let's take the snipe, but
do you know what is
reasonable health?
Yeah, one thing that's really hard now against all the secrets is it's actually your secret. Back in the day, you could always like, oh, it's this or this.
I make this
attack.
Now it's
but
like
there are like so much things everywhere going on.
And they're
on.
All very different as well. Like they require different sequencing to play around them in different orders, right?
You see it again with Lavkazu's face. Just like, oh, it's not cat trick. There can be a beer trick, can be an explosive, can be a freezing.
I think that's one of the most frustrating ones. Yeah. Is cat trick, because. Because it appears after the spell, you can't. It's so difficult to try and deal with in that one turn.
Also, the difference is so big, like with the explosive,
if you try and play round one, you're gonna run into the other. You know,
if it is a freezing here? Like really bad. It's actually low rolls on the companions. Two of the worst to get the. They are both fine, but together they are a little bit weak on this spot.
It's a good setup for Carl, though. He gets two minions on the board. Mm-hmm. One's Taunt, which is super important.
But Huffer traded directly with 5 day attack here. With a Leoc.
Yeah.
Double together, you will maybe prefer the double Taunt. But yeah, still doing a solid job here. Life Coach only having the access to play one card here. That's all he can do. For him, it's still a question if it is like freezing or something. He can also think it's Snake. There can be a lot of...
Well, now he knows it's not Snake. For a start, he did go for the attack in, so he's aware of that. And now I like this play the most, because it's a minion that your opponent now has to try and deal with. Because obviously he will know it's not Snake. Or is he just going to ignore it and leave the Corruptor up now? Because I feel like you do need to close the game out, right?
Yeah, but without Call of the Wild, the game would have been really, really close. And with this Call of the Wild... Ashivald also respected.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Hero Power's gonna get the job done, right? At this point, as long as Misha stays alive.
Nah, this part already does. I like you probably if you were in the worst spot, you should attack face there to go for the lethal play. You also have a beer trap, but it's still like you can attack my face once, but then
then you have to deal with it. Yeah. Okay, and this is what we were obviously Gaara getting Barnes. Mm-hmm. into Yashiraj, into Hymane was a huge turn. Mm-hmm. And I feel like if that didn't happen, then life coach would be in a very, very nice position right about now, probably already sat on this couch.
I think it could even have gone the more clean way. But Gaara played like the value game pretty well. Like at the end, it is still, you have to play a little value. Took a lot of damage for it. But also still doing, I mean, you see the value game is not that clear for the hunter still. Like it's Dragon Ball, you can, has different, sometimes it is really aggressive, but sometimes it can also take it a little slower. So we take too much damage here, right?
I believe so, especially because there's no Manet armor up.
Yeah,
so
we take too much damage here. This is too much to handle.
Yep. So Life Coach's Dragon Warrior finally falling after winning two games in a row versus Gaara, and now this Yashiraj Hunter. But the difference, I think, now is Life Coach knows exactly what deck it is, as opposed to, you know, Hunter can come in even a few forms right about now, but knowing it's Yashiraj means you can alter play style, choose the best deck to go into the match with as well. So I think Life Coach is still in a good position, obviously being 2-1.
Yeah, he also kind of knows now what he's facing, has seen a little bit of the secrets. Maybe he was like still doing that last turn to see if there's some animation
just to try and find
procking.
Out And it didn't proc, right?
And it makes a lot of difference. It didn't proc, but it makes, like, now you know you face this. Like, you're going to keep cards like Execute. You're going to keep cards like Sep for his Rogue. Like, the potential knowledge of, like, knowing you face now this Yashiraj Hunter and not an hybrid, mid-range, whatever Hunter, it's pretty important, actually. Yeah. It's really, really important. You want to maybe even keep the case where they have the Barnes answer. And I think cards like Sep are totally fine keeping now.
Yeah, because the thing is, the 1-1 Yashiraj, even if it pulls another Yashiraj, is actually fine, because a lot of the times as Rogue, you just have dagger anyway at that point and just kill it off, sap off the big one, and then
and
say, okay.
You don't care if they have it in the hand. If they have their 10 mana Yashiraj, you're like, yeah, sure,
in
get
six
there.
Turns, we'll discuss it, but not for now.
And then he doesn't draw anything, or like it doesn't pull anything off, so.
Yeah.
But with this Hunter, so. Yashiraj Hunter against Sue, I don't know if that's good. It's not that good, right? I would say.
I don't know, because sometimes the traps can actually just cause so much havoc. I don't know. It really does depend on if Gaara can get out the Barnes early enough. Because I feel like the second you whiff with Barnes against a more aggressive deck, you kind of can get punished very heavily. But yeah, we'll see. Triple traps opening up for Gaara.
Here,
I imagine this
here
is going to be
actually what I just mentioned. Life Coach having the Sep in the hand and can consider keeping it now. It's up to him if he thinks it's worth it. I think that Barnes, or it gets around just with how much you can mulligan and earn everything. Most of the time it gets, for 40%, it gets played on turn 4 around that. So yeah, I think...
I would like to see it kept, because do you know how you lose this game? As if he goes Barnes, into Yashiraj, and then he's got some problems.
Why did Gaara keep the cat and the explosive trap?
Didn't he keep the cat and the snipe?
I'm not sure. I'm
confused.
Know it,
I know he kept the cat. Maybe he mulliganed the two others, and he drew the two other versions.
I still don't know if that's the playstyle you want to take. Because I just want that Barnes so badly that I feel
just hard,
that
hard mulligan for Barnes.
I don't feel on Ketrick. Ketrick is okay, but I don't think Snipe explodes.
Hey, Snipe pretty much like negates a turn 4 Tomb Pillager though, right? Because you know they're almost always going to go for it.
It's also good against stream drop still.
Okay, so nothing happening too early on for Gaara, as he does have the 2 mana traps available. And now it looks like Life Coach is just going to pass as well.
Yeah, had also not much to do. You can coin a dagger if you want to be aggressive.
Too crazy. But here's where Life Coach starts to stress out now. Life Coach is
knowing Life Coach also, there is going a lot into your... It's always he's consider every option already, but yeah, with so much different secrets, you got to respect.
Yeah. Now it's like now should he attack? Well, he shouldn't attack face, right? Because if it is bear, then you're going to take way more damage. Lock and load getting drawn by Gaara.
Not too great at this point. I think Snipe is pretty solid here. It deals okay with 3 drops. If there comes a coin 4 drop, I would say it's pretty reasonable. Yeah, that can be the coin teacher, but it still already does something.
Who to shoot?
Also, if the coin gets played here, you will summon the cat. So I just feel that you never want a hero power here. I don't like this, actually. I would always play the Snipe here.
Yeah, I agree. Like, even if a 3-drop comes out, you're feeling good about it. But even just to prep it for the following turn. Well, obviously, we can see Snipe. Obviously, we can see Snipe would have not been great, as it would have hit the Argent Squire, just the shield off it. So that would have been pretty terrible. But I feel like playing around that.
Maybe it's too obvious. It's like always the secret you want to play.
Yeah.
So maybe it can spoiler too much.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy.
Yeah, I would say with this Squire already being played, I think Coin Edwin gets pretty appealing. I don't want to pass two mana here with already having spent this one. Yes, they can be the cat trick, but your Edwin is still 6/6.
Yeah, and the thing is as well, like, it can be the cat trick, but you know what? It could be any other trap as well. Like,
Gar just enjoying his time that Lifecrush has no clue what that, just figuring out what the best plays in all these kinds of secrets. What? How to stress Lifecrush you are. Yes, those Dormu is one, but definitely playing
like a million different
playing
secrets.
All the secrets together.
Okay, so cat trick is activated and we see the cat with the hat now onto the board, and it's such a pain to deal with. The fact that it's stealthed is just like so frustrating. But like you said, Van Cleef is a 6/6 anyway, so you're going to feel pretty reasonable about even just proccing the cat trick. You know, there's one secret out the bag, so to speak, so still in an okay position.
Ooh,
here.
Freezing.
So you'd have to quick shot the
it's a little weak, right?
I feel like that's putting a lot into just trying to bounce this Van Cleef. Yeah. You like you want to bounce the Van Cleef so you blow what, 7 damage? Like
Oh man. Okay. I like this also.
It's better mana usage and not as like wasteful, I feel. Like to go that heavy on the freezing when the rogue could actually just not attack with Van Cleef, because it's not like the hunter's ever going to rush him down with this style of deck. So
there are also more good targets for freezing. Pillager is also a fine one. It's not that this Edwin definitely also, but it might still come back even for 5 mana sometimes with a prep. Can already become like a 6/6 pretty easily.
Yeah, and even a 6/6 is a reasonable size. You know, everyone remembers the 10/10s, 12/12s, Van Cleefs, so but 6/6 is a threat in itself.
You can kind of easily make the read here for the explosive, but then there is still the other secret. Yes, you can heal your Edwin out of the range. Is it considering to be worth? Because you have to play the Earthen Ring for that to make the Edwin above the 2 health.
I mean, he does have Cold Blood and Eviscerate in hand, so he's got a lot of damage. It's just whether you...
I think he cannot lose this board. I think I will go for
it. Especially because, you know, if it's freezing, you can just throw the Squire away, right? And you know it's probably not freezing because the Squire is on. It looks pretty... looks pretty okay with the heal there, and the Cold Blood going on to Squire to be able to start pressuring a lot of damage.
2 targets here now, and maybe even the freezing has to be complete here. Like, the freezing still not that appealing. Unleash Quickshot can be okay. I wouldn't mind Unleash Quickshot here too much. I feel the freezing now loses a little bit of the value. I feel it's a great. I think Unleash Quickshot is what you have to consider here.
Yeah, you're taking a lot of damage, and you really just need to, you know, forget about the fact of you're not really developing anything to a certain extent. You just need to stop this damage coming out, because for all you know, there's even more waiting in hand for Live Coach. So I really like this as well. You need to just stem the tide, so to speak, and then build on next turn, because now he's emptied the board, Freezing Trap becomes a little bit better. We've just got a few issues here, so now I actually can't see the game, but we should be having it back on.
We are having sound still.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can see it. You Twitch viewer, you, but we just can't see it for a quick minute here, so we'll be back up to scratch in a second. But yeah, I think with the clearing the board, who's actually in a really good position to make use of the freezing trap going forward, because again, you know, rogue doesn't normally, you know, drop out like 5 minions on the board to make it that difficult. We'd already seen the Argent Squire get used anyway, so
it's really important for Gara now to either get the turn 8 going, where he can like get the Call of the Wild or get the Barnes really soon, because it's still something you wanna get here. Life Coach facing the secret now. Of course you don't know what it is. You won't guess here it's a freezing, I guess.
You'll never know what it is. There's so many secrets.
Yeah, well.
Do you ever actually not attack, though? Like, can you afford to?
I feel like when once there are like weapons in play from the hunter, you often consider. Otherwise, at the end, they are still not kind of worth what they are doing. I feel often the freezing is probably the only secret people won't play just for 2 mana.
Yeah, I think now, like, because Life Coach has been able to check multiple traps, so he checked for bear. He can now, with the Squire especially, because it's a pain to actually deal with. Not attacking is okay because he had the Squire as the backup to say, well, you either go pretty heavy on this Squire or I just bounce the Squire and everything's fine. So in that instance, I do like the lack of attack. And now it
we
feels
have to
like
play the hand here.
Yeah, it looks like at least lock and load snipe.
Yep, that's the start.
And then we'll see
draw
what
like
happens.
Maybe something for 3 mana.
That's a lot of good Hunter 3 mana cards, but Acid Maw is not one of them.
No, you need to wait to turn 10 to combine it with like an Unleash or something. We have to see the kill command here. The kill command's not going to win you the game at this point. You need to cycle a little.
Job's done.
Bloody hell, though. Not terrible.
Nope.
If anything, it's just a lot of damage.
But it also is an okay trade card. You don't take any damage by still making... We are even hearing Life Coach making sounds from, oh no, there is another secret. Yep.
One's already too many. Two, definitely... There's one more secret I think Life Coach would just leave right about now. He's had enough.
Especially this game. It just started from mid secrets. It's going to end with secrets. He's considering if there can be a bear trap now, I think. Makes sense. I mean, nothing.
Okay, so actually nothing.
Yeah.
Well, it could still be freezing, right? So he has the freezing bounce, which is what the Squire's like. We get some really work, getting some great work done this game, making it as awkward as possible for Garen to control the trap usage.
Yeah, and also the snipe counter here is
this
makes
insane.
The card so dead.
And now we can just rock up with the second Tomb Pillager, and suddenly double Tomb Pillager and Eviscerate's looking pretty nice, and Snake Trap is not really what he needs, but Garen's Gladiator's Longbow is going to help him clear up the big guy. Not take any damage before the 6.
Yeah,
already.
With facing already 6 on board, Dagger
that's
is always
game.
Being 1. Giving a coin, I mean, 4 damage. There are ways for Rogue to pretty easily do 4 damage. And here the Eviscerate will take the game. Your poor Life Coach taking the series 3-1.
Yeah, it's a really sort of steady performance by Life Coach. I felt like Gaara had a bit of a rough time of it with some of his decks earlier on as well. But Life Coach just piloting that Dragon Warrior. And you know what? Like. This is what happens when you leave Warrior up. Like,
yeah, but it's also something that can happen if you leave Truda above your red. So it's also something that can happen when you leave Shaman
up. I just feel like Dragon Warrior is like a very, very strong deck, as well as you know the Druid and a couple of others. But Warrior, I just thought would be banned way more than it has been in this tournament so far, at least. You know, what did you think of that series, Nimsh?
Well, it was definitely pretty interesting, specifically seeing that hunter from Gaara. You know, this is the hunter we've seen on ladder. We see on ladder from time to time. I'm not sure how good it is, but it's definitely cool to see it. And Life Coach getting a good win there. He just needs to win one more game to move forward. And I represent G2 because, unfortunately...
Oh, Tice is gone.
Oh, Tice is gone.
There's a third headset.
Yeah, but it's absolutely fine.
Tice already happy
I want
to
give you my
seat. Here, Life Coach, take the headset.
Hey, Life Coach, welcome to the couch.
Okay.
So the most important question is actually, how much did you enjoy that last game?
Oh, the last two games were very much. I had the feeling that there was like one person thing. Oh.
Yeah, I was gonna say before we get into the interview, though, we are just gonna see a quick rundown of the match. So just a quick review of what's been going on, some of the highlights of this.
Yeah, what happened here?
just a lot of dragon synergy with those corruptors more than anything, and a really good clear up for Life Coach.
So it seems like the Dragon Warrior was really powerful again, and this is a deck that will probably stay with us for some time. Like a lot of people try to ban it, but if you don't ban it, it's a valid strategy also not to ban it sometimes. As Ty said, sometimes you just have so many other decks you want to get rid of.
Yeah, we see the win rate with the coin, what was that, 66%?
Yeah, well, with 4 games, it gives
a really good
sample size.
Yeah, definitely. Always interesting to see, though, some of these, even like the game length and things like that as well. So, we see a pretty straightforward game, I would say, overall, this one. You know, but Warrior really just muscling out the Shaymin overall. Yeah, Garra could never really get anything onto the board long enough, and it's a hotly debated topic, like Bloodlust in this deck. It's a lot of players always feel like it's either great or it's very dead, or at least one of the most potential dead cards in the deck overall. And we see Garra had hold of it almost all game as well, so definitely didn't help, but that was the first game where Life Coach managed to pile on the pressure. See Garra just have all the most. We were talking about it when we tied.
Yeah, this was the
awkward turns ever with this deck.
This was the turn where Garra could have maybe swing things around. I've tried to play it risky. The one turn earlier where he called go for the 50-50 to still get this golem one turn earlier.
Yeah,
now he was just one turn too behind. Just one gold turn.
There was the do that the turn earlier with the slight risk of throwing out the Argus.
This was so awesome from Life Coach. Going for this aggressive attack, it made Garra need to like trade three minions into the Dragon Crusher. But
so a quick question, guys: Draconite Crusher or Bookworm? Because I've seen versions that play Bookworm instead of Crusher.
I think Crusher's just way more consistent, and sometimes, or a lot of the time, Crusher allows you to do what we just saw, where it's just pile on so much pressure, your opponent has to deal with it, or just die instead. But we do see now the final game, you know, pretty straightforward one. Garra couldn't really make too much work. I think the best Garra did was stress Life Coach out with the sheer volume of traps he was playing, and have to think about trying to play around, so that was definitely a cool one. But Garra's Yasharaj Hunter not quite being enough to take the series, and Life Coach is here with us, the winner. How stressed were you with the traps?
Well, I was definitely stressed after he played Yasharaj into a Bant into Yasharaj into Hymen, which is like the very best outcome. Mm-hmm. You cannot wish for more. it's the nuts. And so, that's what the deck does. And I also have to say, in the last two games, I had the feeling that I was the only one making the thinking. Not because Garra, I'm not saying that Garra didn't think, but what I'm saying is the matchup is so unequal because, like, as a hunter, you just pump out your secrets. Mm-hmm. Of course, you have to think the one or the other thing, but as the opposition, it's silly. You're sitting there, you know the deck plays all traps.
Yeah.
I was not even sure about Bear Trap. I don't even know whether he plays Bear Trap in his deck. Oh, he played one. Okay, yeah. So
was active when you couldn't attack face at the end of the Warrior match.
Okay.
Because you had to clear the taunt and you went to, like, you couldn't hit face. So you didn't ever see if it was Bear Trap or not. So that was quite funny.
Okay.
So how much have you guys prepared together? How much time have you spent, like, every day to prepare for this tournament specifically?
Yeah, well, 1.5 weeks every day talking about the decks, building the decks. And then basically finally also, I mean, I know it's a little bit secret, but, I mean, we are also playing the identical decks. So we talked in interaction together, and really, I mean, if somebody said, okay, maybe this card might not fit perfectly into this deck, we discussed about it and also agreed at some point, which is not extremely common, right? I mean, it could also be that I say, oh, the card is super strong, tie set is super weak, and then we just conclude something because we cannot get to a result.
At Seed Story Cup, you guys had differences in your decks, like preference picks, right?
So like we had like pretty similar decks. We had
that was coincidence. That was when you already submitted, and I came with this idea overnight. Where I said,
You changed things overnight. But from the five decks, there were like three or four were identical.
Yeah, it was only the OTK which you already submitted, and in the night I thought about it and concluded it's not that great. But yeah,
How much does the team? The fact that your guys are on a team, how much does it help you to grow as players? Because a lot of people still say, like, yeah, you don't need teams in Hearthstone, it's a solo game. But you guys are at the top of the game overall, and you are super strong with the G2. So how much does it help you improve?
Well, I mean, a lot, of course. And some might say maybe it's not. I think it's the special constellation. I mean, yes, we are also in a team, and that makes things better. But I think it's especially that we three guys just understand each other very well and are also on equal playing strength level, so we can interact with each other very well. So that's very important.
I think it's definitely for tournament play. I don't think like ladder gives the right view on how tournaments are getting played. And yeah, I feel I learn a lot where I can like we play like a matchup just 10 times. And then you realize yourself what are the weaknesses, what are the strengths, but what is the issue? And it's just the point that I realized it way better when we are playing these practice matches than once the things happen on ladder games.
All right. Actually,